Welcome to the next lecture. We are looking at momentum fluxes. We derived the momentum balance equation, the equation of motion, and I showed you how applying the equation of motion in some situations, in fact in many situations, can significantly simplify our analysis. The shell balances are robust, however they will take a lot of effort, they are cumbersome, especially in cylindrical and spherical coordinates, whereas the equation of motion, we have already put in the effort, we have derived those equations, we can directly take those equations and apply them as long as we are clear as to their limitations of application. Today, I am going to talk to you about the analysis of flow through a cylindrical pipe. Flow through a cylindrical pipe is so widely used. Okay, you just look around yourself, look around within yourself. There are so many cases of flow through cylindrical pipes. All your vasculature is cylindrical, right? So any flow in the body is flow through a cylindrical pipe. Let me tell you some. So it has significance in a wide variety of situations. The flow in micro devices, if you are interested in fabricating micro devices, lab on a chip and so on and so forth, various different micro devices, they all involve flows which are usually through cylindrical, very tiny cylindrical pipes of tiny diameter. Flow of fluids in the human body, at least as the first approximation is that, flow of liquids and gases in the bioprocess industry are all flow through cylindrical pipes, almost all through cylindrical pipes, and so on and so forth. So it has wide relevance. So pay a little bit of attention, whatever we are deriving here can be applied in a wide variety of situations. Let us consider laminar flow of a Newtonian fluid. Okay, that is the first assumption. We are looking at laminar flow of a Newtonian fluid. Down a cylindrical pipe placed vertical, okay, that is our situation. And we are going to consider the situation when the flow is well developed, okay. Suppose you have a pipe of a certain length. At the entrance, there could be some entrance effects. At the exit, there could be exit effects, okay, or the end effects would be there at the two ends. For a majority of the pipe, the flow would be well developed. There are estimates by which you can get the length to which the flow needs to travel before it gets to well developed flow conditions, as it is called. We have already seen an example of well developed flow when we said that the velocity of a thin layer of fluid flowing over an inclined plate does not change with the distance, okay, which means the flow is well developed there. There are various situations where the flow is well developed. Here the flow is well developed for most of the pipe. So the analysis is relevant for pretty much the entire pipe except for the entrance and exit regions. And the entrance and exits could be few with huge lengths in between. So all there it is relevant. This is the definition of well-developed flow. The axial velocity at any particular radial position in the pipe is not dependent on the length. The axial velocity at any radial position. Okay, it's a cylindrical pipe, so we are looking at radial positions of various diameters, various distances from the center. There, the velocity at a particular point is the same along the length. The velocity at the center would be different from the velocity near the wall. That is perfectly fine. But the velocity near the wall would be the same irrespective of the distance that is traveled in the pipe. That is what we call as the well-developed flow. Okay? In other words, across a cross-section, there would be variation, but across a length, there will not be a variation. Good. We are going to derive the profiles of shear rates and velocities across the tube diameter. That's our main interest here, to get insights. And this is useful in hugely in analysis, design, operation, and so on. The system of interest is cylindrical, and therefore it is best to use a cylindrical coordinate system here. And therefore, check back, go to your table 3.4-2, you made a copy of it, take a look at the copy. We are going to look at equation A2 because it is the case of a Newtonian fluid and laminar flow. Therefore, we can directly use A2. Okay. Rho and the viscosity are constants. The equation A2 is this, is long equation here. Rho dou Vr dou T plus Vr dou Vr dou R plus V theta by R dou Vr dou theta minus V theta squared by R plus Vz dou Vr dou Z equals minus dou P dou R plus mu dou R 1 by R dou R of R Vr plus 1 by R squared of dou squared Vr by dou theta squared plus 2 by R squared of dou V theta dou theta plus dou squared Vr by dou Z squared plus rho gr. This is the equation that you will find, check in table 3.4-2, the copy that you made. Now, we are going to look at the terms that are relevant. We are looking at a steady state case, therefore no time derivatives, the first term goes to 0. There is no velocity in the radial direction, there is velocity only in the axial direction. Therefore, Vr is 0, that goes to 0. V theta, which is the velocity in the theta direction, there is none, there is no circulation there. Therefore, V theta is 0. This term also disappears because V theta is 0. Now, Vz is there. Vz is certainly there, moving down. This is a vertical pipe moving down, Vz. The z direction is the vertical axis. However, Vr is anyway 0. Yeah, we don't have to worry about it. There is no velocity in the radial direction. Okay, let me recalibrate here. This is a vertical pipe. This is the axial direction. This is the radial direction. There is Vz. There is no Vr. There is no V theta. Okay, good. So this term goes to 0. Dp dr, we don't know much. Let's keep that. Vr is 0, therefore this term goes to 0. Vr is 0, so this term goes to 0. V theta is 0, so this term goes to 0. Vr is 0, this term disappears. And gravity acts only in this direction. There is no, the r direction is perpendicular to the gz direction. There is no component of g, and therefore gr is 0. So what do we have here? What is left here? Pretty much nothing else except for this term. So we get this 3.4.2-1. We get dou P dou R equals 0 after we cancel all the relevant terms. Okay. What does this mean? Okay, this means something very powerful or very insightful. There is no variation in pressure across the radius. This is a vertical pipe, right? There is no variation pressure across the radius. The pressure across a cross section is the same. Okay, that's something good to know. We don't have to worry about pressure varying across the cross section in cylindrical flow. So P is not a function of R. That's what we got. So we'll call this equation 3.4.2-2. The pressure across the cross section at a particular length in laminar flow through a pipe does not depend on the radial position. Okay. Note that we are saying that the pressure across the radius is the same. However, the pressure across this radius could be very different from the pressure across this radius. Okay, there could be a variation in pressure with the axial distance. There is no variation in pressure with the radial distance. You need to make these fine distinctions here. Okay, we need to have that picture very clearly in mind. That's an essential aspect of this course. Some more concentration, some more better understanding of the physics is absolutely required here. This happens to be a very important insight. We can now just close our eyes and say across the cross section, the pressure does not vary. Okay, that's very useful. Next, let us consider equation B2 in table 3.4-2. B2 is this same equation. Yeah, this is cylindrical coordinate system 3.4.2. B2 is in terms of the other velocity. This was B1, right? This was, we considered A2, A2, B2 and C2. Okay, we can, A2, equation A2 we considered first, and now we're going to consider B2. This A2 was in terms of Vr and so on and so forth, the B2 is in terms of V theta. This is the equation, please verify. Now we start cancelling the terms. Steady state term, a steady state case, therefore there is no variation with time, this goes to 0. Vr is 0, so this goes to 0, V theta is 0, so this goes to 0. Same reason, this term disappears, this term disappears, this term disappears, this gone, this gone, this gone. And G theta, there is no G in the theta direction, okay. The direction is perpendicular to the vertical direction where it is relevant, and therefore this goes to 0. So the only term that remains is this 1 by r minus 1 by r dou p dou theta equals 0. What does this mean? That there is no variation in pressure across theta. Both put together, there is no variation in pressure across the cross section. This and the radius, theta and radius put together, gives us there is no variation in pressure across the cross section. Dou p dou t equals 0, p is not a function of theta. Okay, so the pressure does not vary with the radial position, the pressure does not vary with the angular position, and therefore the pressure does not vary across a cross section. Okay. Now let us consider equation C2. Okay, we are directly taking these balances and seeing what insights they are giving us. We take equation C2, apply it to here. This is the equation C2 in terms of Vz. This is steady state situation, therefore there is no variation with time, the time derivatives are 0, Vr is 0, therefore this term disappears, V theta is 0, this term disappears. Vz of course exists, however Vz is not a function of Z, well developed flow, okay, therefore the derivative goes to 0, this term disappears. Dou p dou z of course remains. Here we Vz of course varies with r, okay. In the cross section there are different velocities, therefore this term remains. Vz is not a function of theta, this velocity does not vary with theta, therefore this derivative goes to 0. You know, you could see that as dou dou theta of dou Vz dou theta, dou Vz dou theta is 0, therefore this term goes to 0. Similarly, Vz is not a function of z, therefore this term goes to 0. And of course, Gz is in the same direction as relevant, therefore this term remains. So what we get is, okay, I've just transposed this, I've taken this to the other side, minus mu by r dou Vz dou r, that's what this is, equals minus dou p dou z plus rho gz. This is what remains here after cancelling the terms. Equation 3.4.2-6. Now let us define a capital P as pressure, which we have represented as small p throughout, minus rho gz. Okay. This is a vertical case, and we are going to take the pressure, a capital P, this is a new variable here that we are defining as pressure minus rho g z. If we do this, dou p dou z, dou z that we had here minus rho g can be written as dou dou z of p minus rho g z. Okay, that becomes dou capital P dou z. So this can be replaced with this. Okay, I'm combined terms. The use of this would become apparent later, maybe. So, but take it on face value for now. Now Gz is nothing but G, and therefore we could write this equation as mu by R. We are writing this equation here. We are writing this equation here. Mu by r dou dou r dou vz dou r, and this we have replaced with dou p dou z. Mu by r dou vz dou r equals dou p dou z. Equation 3.4.2-7. And we know from these equations, when we substituted earlier, that P is not a function of R and P is not a function of theta. Therefore, the capital P, which we defined as P minus rho gz, is also not a function of R and not a function of theta, because this is the combination that we are looking at. Since capital P is a function of z alone, we could replace the partial derivative here, dou P dou z, only z is the relevant variable here. So there is no longer a partial required here. Okay. So we could replace dou P dou z by the total derivative dP dz. Similarly, Vz and R are functions of R alone. R is R and Vz varies only, Vz varies only with R. It does not vary with z, well-developed flow, or with theta. Therefore, the partial derivative on the LHS also can be replaced by the ordinary derivative. So this R becomes the only variable here. So you could replace the partial with the total. So in the partial derivative equations are much more difficult to solve, as you've seen earlier. But this physical situation allows us to directly write these partial derivatives as total derivatives, because of the variables that are involved have come down to one each on both sides. So we could write 3.4.2-7 as mu by r d dr r dvz dr equals dp dz. Okay. I think let us take a break here. 3.4.2-8. Let me see what I have. Okay. Let's take a break here. It's good to take a break here. We have been with some intense stuff for about 20 minutes. I think it's best to take a break here. Let us continue with the derivation of the relevant relationships for laminar flow of a Newtonian fluid through a cylindrical pipe placed vertically. See you there.